As a person with Parkinson's disease, have you ever asked yourself, self, I wonder if Parkinson's disease could be causing my pain, or at least causing my pain to get worse? Well, if you've asked yourself that question, you would not be alone. That's the topic we're going to be talking about in this week's video. Before we get started, be sure to smash that like button, subscribe to the channel, and please let me know in the comments your experiences with pain and Parkinson's disease as we discuss this together. My name is Dr. Michael Hyland. I'm a doctor of physical therapy. Welcome to the video. So pain and Parkinson's disease. Yes, Parkinson's disease can, in and of itself, result in pain. There are five common areas or causes, potentially, for Parkinson's to cause pain. Those five areas are musculoskeletal, neuropathic, dystonic, akathisia, and central nervous system. So let's discuss the first one, musculoskeletal. Musculoskeletal refers to muscles in the body, the skeleton, bones, the joints, and the ligaments, the tendons, and so forth. There's a lot of things that go into musculoskeletal pain with Parkinson's disease. One of the things that is important to remember is that Parkinson's disease, due to its nature, results in many impairments of the musculoskeletal system. And those are secondary impairments because the primary impairment is neurological, but the secondary impairments can be in the body. So we see rigidity, muscle weakness, and of course we mentioned dystonia as one of the types of pain associated with that. We'll get to that in a moment. But it's important to remember that as the trunk becomes more rigid, as posture becomes more stooped, that's due to muscle weakness and also due to stiffness. So that can result directly in stress to the joints. For example, the joints in the neck, the joints in the upper back, the ligaments surrounding those joints. It can stretch the muscles out too much. And that can cause a lot of discomfort. Just imagine for a moment, if you were to take your index finger and bend it backwards, just bending it backwards and just keep it there. Keep it there, getting a little uncomfortable. So just imagine that you're doing this all day long and you're doing it day in and day out. That's basically what's happening to the joints in your spine, in your neck, you know, wherever it is in the spine. If there's abnormal stress placed on those joints, that's going to result in ligament stress, stretching things that shouldn't be stretched, and so forth. That causes a lot of pain and discomfort. And a lot of times when people complain of aches and pains, that's part of what you're probably feeling. Not necessarily arthritis or joint pain, although that could be present as well, but you could be feeling discomfort and fascia restrictions and ligament strain and so forth. The second cause is neuropathic. Neuropathic basically refers to nerve pain or neuropathy. In a previous video, I'll link up here, actually up here, or up here. In a previous video, we talked about neuropathy and what the potential causes of that are, so I won't go into detail about that. But Parkinson's disease is very, very much associated with neuropathies. And neuropathic pain can be extremely painful. From anywhere from burning to pins and needles, could be in the hands and or the feet. It could be in actually other places like the entire limb, sciatic pain and things like that. So neuropathies certainly can be an aggravating source of pain because they're hard, difficult to treat at times. So one of the things that would be important to consider with neuropathic pain is to discuss that with your movement disorder specialist or your neurologist, especially when it comes to supplements and things that can help, such as B6 and B12, when it comes to your nerve health with Parkinson's. Moving on down the list, now we have dystonia. Dystonia refers to involuntary muscle contractions. Parkinson's disease is notorious for causing this in certain individuals, and it's quite painful because if you could just imagine a muscle spasm going off somewhere at random and you can't stop it, no matter how much you stretch it or how much you try to relax it or put heat on it. It's neurological. It's not going to let go just because you wanted to, but it's obviously very painful. Dystonia can happen in so many different places. I've seen it happen in people's upper body. I've seen it happen where the feet, the toes and the feet curl in. I've even seen it in the trunk where people kind of get all, you know, twisted up because of it. That's something that we'll discuss, you know, remedies to all these things in just a few, in just a moment. But it's important to know that that is something that's associated with Parkinson's that can also cause pain and can also cause deformities, like we talked about earlier, with the muscles and the joints. Okay, next on the list is akathisia. Akathisia? Just kidding, it's akathisia. So akathisia, or akathisia, is referring to the inability to become comfortable or to feel, to get rid of a sensation, the inability to get rid of a sensation. And so that's basically like your restless leg syndrome, things like that. An icky feeling, jerky, you can't really get rid of it in the legs. That's also associated with Parkinson's, and there are various causes of restless leg syndrome. I also did a video on that that you can see up here. Lastly, we have the central nervous system. So Parkinson's disease tends to affect the central nervous system. Obviously, Parkinson's lives in the central nervous system. It's a brain disorder. But there are other effects of Parkinson's disease besides simply the area in which is damaged, which is the substantia nigra pars compacta. The autonomic nervous system is directly impacted by Parkinson's disease. And there are areas of the brain, such as the thalamus, that directly correlate or directly relate to pain. And so if any of those areas are affected negatively by Parkinson's, there may be pain basically being generated by the brain itself. And that's really tough to treat. And unfortunately, that can be a reality for some people with Parkinson's disease. What are the remedies? So number one, of course, is dopamine. Proper dopamine levels help to counteract some of the negative effects that can be associated with Parkinson's disease. We talked about some of the effects that Parkinson's has on the body. With increased dopamine, those effects are lessened. Also, dopamine is a neurotransmitter of pleasure in our brain. So a good feeling can come, or better feeling can come, from having a higher level of dopamine in our bloodstream and in the brain. Number two is Botox, or botulinum toxin. Botox can be often used to paralyze muscles that are problematic when it comes to dystonia, or those uncontrolled muscle spasms that can happen in some people with Parkinson's disease. So that's something you can ask your doctor about, particularly your neurologist, if that is an ongoing issue for you. Next is DBS, or deep brain stimulation. Deep brain stimulation literally takes electrodes, electrical impulses, and targets them to the areas of the brain that produce dopamine deep in the midbrain. Deep brain stimulation directly impacts the ability to contract the muscles and to move the way you want to move. So most often, or quite often with DBS, folks that have had dystonia and other issues like that, it can be resolved with adjustment of the DBS. Next on the list is corrective surgery. I don't always like to recommend surgery as a physical therapist. However, there are most definitely cases where surgery is necessary, particularly when it comes to needing something like a total joint replacement, or in the case of pathologic fractures, like due to osteoporosis or other causes, maybe a fall caused a fracture. There are certain repairs that may need to be done. For example, spinal kyphoplasty or vertebroplasty to repair a fracture of a vertebra. Joint replacement, as I mentioned, arthroscopic surgeries. There are multiple types of surgeries that may be necessary to correct pain, especially if it's pain as a secondary relation to Parkinson's. There are other things that can come with aging, such as osteoarthritis, that may have already been there without Parkinson's, but Parkinson's disease certainly could make them more pronounced. Lastly, complementary and alternative remedies could be sought out. For example, especially when it comes to muscle contractions, involuntary muscle contractions, and trying to relax things, Looking into things like CBD oil or other forms of cannabis. That's just one example of a complementary or alternative remedy. But there are others, acupuncture, acupressure, chiropractic, things like that. Those are always options, especially when pain is a chronic issue for you as a person with Parkinson's disease. Well, that's all I've got about pain and Parkinson's disease. Just know that there are remedies out there, and sometimes it takes multiple avenues to get relief from pain. Lastly, and one thing that is not on this list that I gave you, but is extremely important, is physical activity and physical exercise, especially exercise that's targeted to Parkinson's disease, because it can directly result in improvements in some of the negative changes that can happen in the body, such as rigidity of the trunk and muscle tightness, joint tightness, and things like that. So, and also stimulating the brain to produce more dopamine, that's something that can happen with exercise in addition to the medications you're taking for Parkinson's disease. I hope that this video was helpful to you in some way, at least to have the knowledge that it's not all in your head. Parkinson's disease can very well cause pain, and honestly, you may hear from a physician that it doesn't, but don't listen to that, because there is definitely very documented evidence that Parkinson's disease can result in pain one way or the other. I would highly recommend you check out Parkinson.org. That's the Parkinson's Foundation, or American Parkinson's Disease Association. If you're here in the United States, those would be great resources to learn even more about what we're talking about in this video today. Thanks for watching. As always, be empowered. My name is Dr. Michael Hyland, physical therapist. I'll catch you in the next video.